today's goal is to define diamonds and do some basic stuff with them. And so let's start right away defining private automorphisms, which play an important role. So a morphism, let's say f from y to x of perfectoid spaces. Sorry, of affinoid perfectoid spaces. Is, let's call it affinoid proetar. If it can be written as an inverse limit of a co-filtered system of etale maps fi from xi to x, or let's say yi to x, where the yi are again affinoid. Wait a second. Okay, so you just take any inverse limits, like on the inverse limits that you have to say co-filtered of such etale maps. Well, I should maybe remark that the category of affinoid perfectoid spaces has all inverse limits.
You mean filters or even?
Well, I mean, you also have fiber.
You have the final object.
As all. Connected, I have to say, right? Is that? I mean, the indexing category has to be connected because. Sorry. So, in other words, this reduces to co filtered guys and fiber products. and. Okay, then maybe you want a notion for all spaces. And let's just say that the morphism from Y to X of general perfectoid spaces is proetal. If it is locally on source and target. I should warn that these notions are really not so well behaved in general. So, say if you have such a map of affinoid perfectoid spaces and maybe locally on X, it is affinoid proetar, then it's not clear that it's globally affinoid proetar. Because it's not clear if you have local choices for these etale maps how to build global choices. So, for schemes, there is a counterexample to this, and I believe it adapts to this case. Similarly, this notion of proetal for perfectoid spaces has also some caveats that you can't really check it locally on X in some in the proetal topology. Or, I mean, there are some small caveats to this, but they will be addressed in a second. But let me first state so you can define a proetal site. Where covers are generated by
say, open covers and surjective affinal proton maps.
And although the sides somehow may not be so well behaved, but the associated topos is actually a pretty canonical object. So, anyway, so you have the following theorem that this side is subcanonical. Also, if X is a finite perfectoid, the Poincare cohomology of OX plus is almost zero for bigger than zero. And in degree zero, it is what you think. I should say that OX is a sheaf. It also works plus. Let me very briefly sketch why this is true. So last time we had a similar result for the etale side. And so this implies that if you send some x, which is some spar rr plus, to r plus mod pi for some fixed pseudo-uniformizer pi, you really can't really choose this globally on the whole category of perfectoid spaces. But whenever you work over some fixed x, you can somehow choose it on x and then take the pullback to everybody above. So, and if you want to check that something's a sheaf, you can always somehow work over some base space. So this thing is almost an etale sheaf, meaning that if you pass to the almost category, it becomes an etale sheaf. And it's almost a cyclic. Okay. But and now if you want to pass to the pro setting, then if you have some inverse limit of some spar ri plus, this is some spar r infinity plus, then actually the, and this is co-filtered. Then actually the r infinity plus mod pi is just a direct limit of the ri plus mod pi. So this is essentially how you compute the inverse limits. You just take the direct limits of the ri pluses and then pi-adic complete to get the r infinity plus and then invert pi again to get r infinity. But this means that this sheaf is somehow on the Poincare side, you get it by just somehow evaluating it on, so assume that this is some kind of Poincare thing over your base space over spar r plus. Then if you evaluate on this Poincare thing, you just get the direct limit of all the values on the etale things. And then the Poincare sheaf properties just follows by taking filtered direct limits from the etale sheaf property.
What about composition of affinoid Poincare maps?
They are still affinoid Poincare.
But it's just not clear how to, when you take the limit, it's not clear how to get to descend on the etale map. To, so if you have got z to y, which is etale, how do you slightly descend it to something over yi to get?
You just can certainly descend it to something etale. The question is whether it's still a affinoid. You can certain, so there is a statement that if you look at quasi-compact, quasi-separated etale maps to some limit, then this is a two-categorical direct limit of the quasi-compact, quasi-separated etale maps to some.
Like what you said, like what you said, explaining the etale in the previous sense of In a sense, you explained last time.
Yes.
You locally can write it. Okay. Yes. But then you have to show it's a finite.
Then I have, wait. That is. Sorry, maybe I only. Do I claim that in general these compositions are finite proton? No, sorry, I don't think I. Sorry, I take back that claim that in general affinite Poincare maps are composed to affinite Poincare maps. But you could assume that these are some kind of. Well, it doesn't really matter. You can assume that these are composites of rational embeddings and finite etale maps in practice, in which case you can get through what you want. I mean, for all the. I don't really care so much about this very notion of a finite Poincare. I more care right now about the notion of the topos it generates, and for this it doesn't really matter. Right, so there is this problem that the notions are slightly tricky to check. And I want to address this in some sense locally in the Poincare topology. So this can be resolved. So this is based on the following definition. I say that a perfectoid space X is totally disconnected. Respectively, strictly totally disconnected. Well, I need that it's quasi compact and quasi separated, but more crucially, the condition is that any open cover splits in the totally disconnected case. Or any etale cover has a splitting. In the strictly totally disconnected case. So meaning that, I mean, if you have some ui to x, some etale open cover, then I want that the map from the disjoint union to x has a splitting. A section. And it follows from, like, essentially arguing like the existence of algebraically closed fields or algebraic closures that whenever you have, say, QCQS perfectoid space to start with, you can build one which is Poincare over it and which is strictly totally disconnected. So if X is any, well, let me actually say this with a finite. Um,
we can always find a surjective affinoid proteinal map x tilde to x. This x prime strictly totally disconnected. So it just somehow takes the inverse limit of all possible etale maps to x in some sense. x tilde, yes, thank you. What will be important later a little bit is that you can even arrange this map to be open, and even open after any base change. But I think this will only be important for some arguments that I'm not going to explain. So this means that locally in this proteinal topology, your spaces somehow are such strictly totally disconnected guys. So how do they look like? So you can give a classification result for strictly totally disconnected and also just totally disconnected guys. They're pretty simple. If and only if. First of all, x has to be a finoid. And every connected component of x is extremely simple. is of the form the p-adic spectrum of some kk plus, where k is a perfectoid field. And k plus and k is a bounded and open. Variation sub. So these are the kind of spaces that takes the role of points in the world of p-adic spaces in some sense. So whenever you have a point of an p-adic space, you always get a non-Archimedean field k, which is some of the residue field at this point, plus such an open and bounded valuation subring, which corresponds to the valuation on k corresponding to the point you're taking. And then you always get a map from spark kk plus into your space. But this is a totally ordered chain of points. But I should finish the statement first. So this is in the totally disconnected case. In the strictly totally disconnected case, you also need to assume that k is algebraically closed. This is a totally ordered chain of points. Okay, so you've essentially completely torn apart your space, that it's just so. Let me make a remark that you always have a map from x to pi naught of x, where pi naught of x is some profinite set. Same topological spaces. That's true for any spectral space.
So you have this profinite set of connected components, and all the connected components are really simple. And so you've essentially lost all geometry after you did this. Okay.
What is the notation mod?
The underlying topological space. Here.
But in defining it as an attic space, you have to restrict the structure shape and then do some completion, probably, in general, for connected component.
That's right. Yes, yes. So I mean by connected component, I mean somehow the...
They are just closed.
They are closed, yes. Yeah, but they are inverse limit of open and closed subsets. Yeah. Each of these open and closed subsets is itself in a finite perfectoid space. And then you take the inverse limit in the category of affinoid perfectoid spaces too. Let's see what this means. Yeah. Okay, so in particular, if it's strictly totally disconnected, then I would write these guys as sparse CC plus, so it's just a lot of C's. And then if you crush a lot of C's together, it's a diamond. Did anybody get this joke? Okay, so so locally, you are of this form. And if you are of this form, then actually you can classify these proetal maps more geometrically. So if X is strictly totally disconnected, and F from X prime to X is a quasi-compact, and separated map, but I should say what separated means. The easiest way to say it is that separated just means that the map from X prime to the underlying topological space of the fiber product has closed image. So for schemes, that's one possible characterization. You can take it as a definition. Here, there are several equivalent characterizations. So you can also prove a variative criterion for separatedness. OK, we need the separatedness condition here. OK, so then for such maps, you can characterize when they are proetal. So then F is proetal. If and only if. the following happens, that for all ranked 1 points of X, or let's say equivalent here for all generic points of X, so this corresponds to some sparse C OC mapping to X. So I said that the connected components are always such spare KK pluses, which are a totally ordered chain of points. And in every such connected component, there's a unique generic point and also a unique special point. But as considered a unique generic point, this corresponds to the maximal generalization of this variation, which just is the one which forgets essentially about the K plus and replaces it just by the ring of integers, by the ring of power bounded elements inside of the field K. So you'll only look at those points. You want it for all these generic points. If I look at the fiber product, this is at spectrum of COC, that this is just some profinite set. So I'm moving to S times sparse COC.
for some profinite set S. What does this S underline times mean? So if you have a profinite set, you can write it as an inverse limit of finite sets. And this product is the inverse limit of the products with the finite sets. So if you have something which is a phenoid proetale over just a geometric point like so, then all the etale maps are just given by finite sets over it. And so the kind of affinoid proetale things should just be given in this way by profinite sets. And so that's the only thing you have to check. You only have to check that at the generic points, you are such a profinite set. And in this case, if you are proetale, you're actually a affinoid proetale.
Is it true also without strictly, but taking the algebraic closure of k, the complete algebraic closure for every generic point?
Is it true if I drop this strictly and then ask the same thing just for algebraic closures? Good question. I wasn't able to verify this when I did this, and one problem I had was that if you have such a spark KK plus where K is not algebraically closed and then you pass to a finite etale cover, then in general this is not somehow local anymore. You may have different closed points. If you take such a local space spark KK plus, which has a unique closed point, and then pass to a finite etale cover, you pass to a finite etale cover of it, then it may have different closed points, several different closed points. And this was slightly complicating the arguments. So for this reason, it was easier to really assume that you're in the strictly totally discrete.
So another question, a small one, about the closed image and definition of separated. Is it like for schemes that for affine or affinoids, you have a kind of a closed immersion that is a topological quotient of the...
Yes, yes. So for affinoids, this is always true. And then this is a closed immersion in every possible sense. So it's even defined by equations. right. And so in general, the diagonal map will be some kind of locally closed immersion as for schemes. And then asking that it has closed image implies that it's a closed immersion in some sense of the word. So in this secret manuscript, there's a discussion about these notions and so on. Okay, so this means that over such a strictly totally disconnected base, these notions of proetale and affinoid proetale, at least under these small hypotheses, especially the separation hypotheses, they're equivalent to the minimal thing you would certainly ask for a proetale map to be satisfied, namely that over geometric points it's given by profinite sets. And so this means that in this case, you're satisfied with the notion. And then in general, maybe you'll like to redefine the notion. So a notion that becomes more important later than a proetale is what I call quasi-proetale. So if after any base change, two is strictly totally disconnected, x tilde that map is proetale.
And then at least for morphisms which are in addition quasi-compact and separated, you can just check this by checking that for all such geometric rank 1 points mapping to X, the fiber is a profinite set. And then if the morphism is not separated, I mean, there are again some subtleties to this definition, but at least in the separated case, which is, one can often arrange things to be separated. This is a good notion. OK, so finally, we can define diamonds, OK? A diamond is a Proyttor sheaf on the category of perfectoid spaces of characteristic P. This is important. such that Y can be written as a Proyttor sheaf. Y. Such that Y can be written as a quotient. Y is X mod R. OK, so I'm here implicitly identifying a space with a sheaf it represents. So I'm using no notation for the Yonida embedding. As a quotient y x mod r, where x is a perfectoid space. And r in x times x is a Proyttor equivalence relation. Meaning that the maps, the source and target maps from R to X are Proyttor. So also the R itself should be a perfectoid space. Maybe I should write representable somewhere. OK, so a priori, you might fear that this definition is sensitive to these subtleties about the notion of a Proyttor morphism. But actually, it's not sensitive to these issues. Why? So whenever you can write y in such a way, you can, without loss of generality, also assume that x is just a disjoint union of strictly totally disconnected guys by passing to a further Proyttor covering. So x is a disjoint union strictly totally disconnected. And so then R in X times X is a subspace. And this is a separated space. And then by some general nonsense, R must be separated.
Isn't the disjoint union not again strictly totally disconnected?
Well, it might not be quasi-compact anymore. I mean, so this disjoint union is only necessary because the space might not be quasi-compact, and you need more and more spaces to fill out more of the space. then the equivalence relation is automatically separated, which also implies that the map is separated. And so now you're in the situation where you have the basis, a disjoint union of strictly totally disconnected spaces, and the map is separated. And then, to check that something is proetale, you can somehow check it on quasi-compact open subsets. So we are in the situation where the proposition applies.
An equivalence relation on a diamond represented by a diamond where the maps are in the same sense proetale in the weak, very weak sense, then it's
right. So Ofagawa was asking whether if I now do this procedure again and try to take a quotient of a diamond by some kind of proetale, quasi-proetale equivalence relation, is it still a diamond? And this is true. So as for algebraic spaces and so on. So this notion of a diamond has very good stability properties. And so as I said, so one justification for the name is that how do you get a diamond? You take some strictly totally disconnected guy, which is just a bunch of C's, totally disconnected, and then you smash them together. In particular, this way of looking at a diamond makes it not obvious that they have a nice geometric structure. But okay, so. I claim that you can still define smooth maps and so on. But this will take some time and will only be done maybe at the end of the next lecture. Okay, so let's do some examples. So the first thing I want to do is I want to relate this to the kinds of spaces we're usually interested in. And so there the claim is the following, that the original natural functor from analytic etic spaces over ZP to diamonds extending the functor from all perfectoid spaces. To perfectoid spaces of characteristic P. Which are a full subcategory here, and these are a full subcategory here. taking X to X tilde. So in this sense, you can define the tilde of any such analytic etic space now. Will be such a diamond. Okay. So let me first give you the intuitive definition.
So say X is an analytic etic space. ZP. Then you just choose some projectile cover X tilde to X, where X tilde is perfectoid. Let me not make completely precise by what I mean by this, but say an example would be that you just take the torus here in the example I did yesterday and then take the inverse limit of all multiplication by p-maps or p's power maps, then the inverse limit is such a perfectoid space. So then, if you look at the fiber product, this is projectile over a perfectoid space. And so there's some subtleties here, what I mean by the fiber product, because I need to do some uniform completion here, really. But if you do it right, this R will again be perfectoid, the equivalence relation you get here. And then define X diamond to be, you take this perfectoid cover, which you can tilt, and you can also tilt the equivalence relation. And then you get this. The obvious problem with this approach is that even if you can make sense of all the words I said here, it's not clear a priori that what you get is independent of the choice. And so, for this reason, the official definition goes differently. So let's say X is an analytic etic space over ZP. Then you define X diamond as a following sheaf. And let's say I only define it on affinoids, because it's supposed to be a sheaf, you can then extend to all perfectoid spaces. This is perfectoid of characteristic P. So the idea is that it should be all maps from this perfectoid space to X. But this is of characteristic P, and this might be of characteristic 0, so there are no such maps. And so the way to correct this is that you don't necessarily ask that you map this given perfectoid space to X, but maybe instead some untilt, which has some of the same information anyway, in some sense. So the definition is the following, that it's sent it to the following data. So this here is some perfectoid algebra, which is an untilt of R in the sense that if you tilt R sharp again, it is R. And then any such untilt automatically comes with a distinguished choice for a plus subring. And so then you just want the map from this spar R sharp plus. You take such data up to isomorphism. With the remark that there are no automorphisms.
And so the theorem is that this is really a diamond. And can be calculated as above. Let me summarize this, but can be calculated intuitively. Meaning this way. Well, I mean, if you define some sheaf on some category, some moduli problem, then you do divide by isomorphisms. Well, you usually want to divide by isomorphisms. But usually, this is not so well behaved if they are automorphisms of objects, right? Like the moduli space of elliptic curves and so on. And so, but this is not an issue for us because there are no automorphisms of these objects. So it's really a well behaved thing to just divide by automorphisms. Well, by isomorphisms. Okay. Let me briefly say something about the proof. So first you need to check that this is actually a proetal sheaf. And that's actually a little bit of work in making in the tilting and untilting procedure, because you I mean, it's even the sheaf if you forget about this map to X. So adding this map back to X back in is easy. So the question is whether sending a perfectoid space to the set of untils is a Poincare sheaf. And you can prove this, but it's some work to do. Okay. So then, if X happens to be perfectoid, the tilting equivalent says that perfectoid spaces over X are equivalent to perfectoid spaces over X tilt via Y maps to Y tilt. So if you have a base space, then perfectoid spaces over that are equivalent. Without a base space, the tilting is, of course, not an equivalence. And if you think about what this means here, it's exactly saying that this X diamond is equal to X flat. So if I'm looking for untilts which map to my given X, then by this equivalence, it must be some of the unique untilt under this equivalence. So this means that in general, for perfectoid spaces, you know what happens. And then in general, you may assume it's affinoid. And then there is an argument due to Fontaine and Colmes, maybe, that there exists some sequence of finite etale GI torsors H to AI. Some kind of filtered sequence. with A infinity, which is a completed direct limit, the AIs completed, which then gets an action of G, which is the inverse limit of the GIs, such that this is perfectoid. Essentially, just, well, one way to do it is just take an inverse limit over all possible finite etale covers, pass to some universal cover. At least if a X is connected, it's easy to do. It's also enough to just take some enough p-power roots, except if this is of mixed characteristic, you have to be a bit careful because extracting p-power roots is not a finite etale procedure, so you have to slightly change the equation and do some Artin-Schreier covers, but you can somehow extract some approximate piece roots by some finite etale covers, and then this means that in this algebra you will have enough approximate p-power roots. No, these are finite, say. And then in the inverse limit, you get something. Sorry?
Okay, you use some perturbation of taking piece roots, so it can the gamma group can be slightly. Okay, you don't control if it's a big one.
Yeah. No, actually, so actually, the argument I make is in the paper, if A is. I mean, I really pass through the universal cover, and I make some sense of this if A is not connected. And then you just need to check that after you pass through this inverse limit, that it always has approximate p-power roots, and for this you just write down any Artin-Schreier cover, and you don't care about the Galois group anymore. Okay, so anyway, you can do this. And then then you can define some x till infinity, which is some spy a infinity plus, and then x diamond will be isomorphic to the tilt of this x infinity modulo an action of this profinite group G. Well, I mean the equivalence. I mean, this notation is not exactly consistent with this notation because the equivalence relation for a group action is really the group times the space with the projection and the action map. But okay, so that's, okay, so for example, so if I take the edX spectrum of GP, say, and I compute its diamond, then this will be the edX spectrum of, say, the cyclotomic extension, which you have to tilt by the action of the Galois group CP cross. And if you tilt this, you get the edX spectrum of the field FP, the wrong series in T and all its p-power roots, which has a certain natural action of CP cross, where explicitly if you have an element gamma in here, then gamma of T is 1 plus T to the gamma minus 1. And then you can also take products. Some kind of absolute fiber product. And so here's a fiber product. It's now over FP. And why is it over FP? That's precisely because we insisted that somehow we only work with perfectoid spaces of characteristic P. If we worked with all perfectoid spaces, then the base would somehow still be ZP. So. So this is the main reason that I want to work with this perfectoid space of characteristic P, because then it's a more absolute theory. OK, so there's another funny example. So for this, let me make the following remark, that if T is any topological space, one can define a pro-etal sheaf T underlined, which has implicitly occurred a couple of times already. So in particular, we can make sense of this formula above there with this profinite set, also using this definition. Can find a pro-etal sheaf T underlined by saying that the T underlined of any X is the continuous maps. Let's write C0, so this means continuous maps from the underlying topological space of X into T. So you can, this is a sheaf because all the covering maps are quotient maps. And so continuity can be checked after a covering. And so there's the following claim, that if T is any compact Hausdorff space, and K is any perfectoid field, say, then if I take this sheaf corresponding to this topological space, this compact Hausdorff space, and I base change it to spar K OK, then this is a diamond. So it's maybe slightly surprising that the theory of compact Hausdorff spaces sneaks in to this world now. Why is this true? Well, there's this funny statement that whenever you have any compact Hausdorff space, you can always find a surjective map from a profinite set onto it. There exists a surjection S to T, where S is profinite. this is some kind of classical fact. I think the easiest argument for this is that you can take for S the Stone-Cech compactification of T as a discrete set. So the Stone-Cech compactification of any discrete set is a profinite set. And it's universal for maps. So maps from the set into any compact Hausdorff space are the same as maps from the Stone-Cech compactification to this compact Hausdorff space. And there's an obvious map from T into T, the identity. And by the universal property of the Stone-Cech compactification, this extends to a map from the Stone-Cech compactification to T. And it's obviously surjective because always map from T to T was surjective, and so you get what you want. But then the equivalence relation S times TS is a closed subspace here. And this is a profinite set. So R, the equivalence relation, is also profinite. And so this means that then this funny sheaf here, you can actually write it as this profinite set times the point, which is a perfectoid space, and you divide by the representable equivalence relation given by this equivalence relation here.
Yes, of
characteristic P. Yeah. Okay, maybe it's time for a break. All right. So, actually, an important technique for much of what will follow. Is what's called redescent. So the V topology on perfectoid spaces is generated by, well, again, open covers and all surjective maps of affinoids. So you basically allow everything to be a cover. And then the world is nice. So the V topology is subcanonical. The question was whether the diamond functor is fully faithful. It's not, just because if somehow forgets the structure morphism. So somehow if you have two perfectoid spaces with the same tilt, they're identified. Structure morphism to ZP. What's more sensitive to us is whether if you say look at analytic spaces of a QP to diamonds over the spar QP diamond. Whether this is fully faithful. And this is known to be true for semi-normal rigid spaces. So under a finiteness condition, you need semi-normality because the diamond functor, it will turn universal homeomorphisms into isomorphisms. And so in particular, the semi-normalization map is always a universal homeomorphism, so it will forget about this. But then on semi-normal rigid spaces, one can prove that it's fully faithful.
So you with the structure morphism.
Yeah, right. So maybe I should write this down somewhere. So. There's a following theorem. I think essentially due to Kittler and Liu, that if you look at semi-normal rigid spaces over QP to diamonds over spar QP diamond. This is fully faithful.
And is it all the any non-Archimedean?
Yes, you could take any non-Archimedean field of characteristic zero here. But it's critical that it's of characteristic zero, because otherwise also the Frobenius map will be sent to an isomorphism. It's an interesting question whether you can prove something like this for some analytic etic spaces or some formal schemes which are flat over ZP and have some normality condition. In this case, it also has a chance to be true. It's subcanonical. OX, OX plus a sheaves, V sheaves. And also if X is a finoid, perfectoid. The higher V cohomology is almost zero. Okay, so in particular, any diamond defines a V-sheaf. Any perfectoid space defines a V-sheaf. Part 2 says that actually also all diamonds are V-sheafs.
And also the cohomology of OX is.
So the cohomology of OX is then 0 in positive degrees, which is a consequence of this by just inverting a pseudo uniformizer. All diamonds are V-sheaves. So 2 is an analog of a theorem of Gabber. I don't know, from something like 2012, that all algebraic spaces without any quasi-separatedness condition are FPQC sheaves. Okay, so it may be surprising that you can control all surjective maps here. For general etic spaces, you can't even control open covers. But perfectoid spaces are so nice that all surjective maps are good. So why does this happen that you can control everything? So by using pro-etale descent, you can essentially reduce to considering only totally disconnected spaces. You might even consider strictly, but I think for what I've been saying, it's enough to consider totally disconnected spaces. But then there's a funny thing, so that if X is strict, if totally disconnected, and Y, so let's say this is some spar R R plus, and Y is any affinoid perfectoid spar SS plus mapping to X, then there is some automatic flatness happening.
then the map from R plus mod pi to S plus mod pi is flat. And it's faithfully flat. If f, if this if y to x is surjective. And so the rest of the V descent then follows from flat descent. Again, you work on this level mod pi first and then in some almost world and then go back. Where does this flatness come from? Well, you can check this on connected components. But then this is just some k plus mod pi, and where k plus is a valuation ring. And so k plus to s plus is automatically flat as it's torsion free. Over variation ring flatness can be checked just by checking torsion freeness. And so by base change, also the map mod pi is flat.
Your connected component is just closed. So you check on it.
I mean, these are both sheaves on the set of connected components. And to check whether it's flat, you can check at local rings. And then the local rings are somehow given by what you see on the connected component. I mean, it takes a little bit of justification to make this precise, but that's the essential idea, that once you are such a totally disconnected base, you can essentially reduce, I mean, at least often you can reduce things actually to connected components by an extra argument. But this connected component is just a valuation ring, so you get a lot of properties for free. Okay, and then, okay, so that's the sketch for one. For two, you actually need some strong V descent properties. Okay, so I want to state some of those. Okay, so let's say we are in the following situation. Let F be a pre-stack, meaning just a functor to groupoids without any properties, on the category of perfectoid spaces. Then for a map from y to x, let me denote by f of y over x the category of descent data. Meaning a class in f of y plus an isomorphism in f of y times xy, such that was a co-cycle condition. So there is a functor from f of x to f of y over x. And f is a V stack, if and only if this is an equivalence for all V covers.
right?
Well, you also need to do that disjoint union is the product. Yeah, the f of disjoint union is the product. Otherwise, it's not doesn't follow from the.
Okay, plus compatible with disjoint unions. Okay, and so I've made this digression here because the descent results will be slightly tricky to formulate in terms of that something is a V-sheaf. You can only say that if X happens to have some property, then this kind of equivalence holds. And so, okay, so let me try to say this. If F is a thing which sends X to all perfectoid spaces over X, then the functor from F of X to F of Y over X is at least fully faithful for all V covers Y over X. So that's an analog of the separated condition for a sheaf. But it might not be the case that whenever you have a given perfectoid space over a V cover and the descent datum, that you can descend to a perfectoid space on X. And I think that's even false for schemes, right? for the etale topology. I mean, there are these families of genus 1 curves, which are not globally a scheme, but it's how locally they are a scheme, right? But you might hope that under extra conditions, things are better. So now if instead I consider, let's say, F affinoid, which takes which is only defined on the category of affinoid X, and maps it to the category of affinoid perfectoid. Oh, affinoid perfectoid. Somebody should resolve this question that one implies the other. positively. if I consider this functor, then well, this functor is still fully faithful always, but it's an equivalence. If X is totally disconnected. So if you're trying to descend something to a totally disconnected space, and your total space is affinoid, then you can do this. It fails more generally. But this is a failure. Well, you don't see it for schemes. And some usual flat topology, say, because by usual FPQC descent. But it fails already in rigid geometry. For smooth affinoid rigid spaces. Yeah, I mean, also for the perfectoid case. The examples are rather stupid. You can find some open subsets of a rigid space, which becomes an affinoid or even a rational subset after a covering of the space, but it's not globally affinoid. It's for the two-dimensional ball. So I just wanted to say that it's a failure which is already somehow in some kind of classical setup visible. And didn't cause much trouble there. So then you can look at, what else do I want to say? Where am I here? If I look at separated and parietal maps, which say you can again do on all effectoid guys, so it maps it to this category of separated. Well, again, fully faithfulness follows from one. The question is whether you can, in some sense, prove descent, effectivity of descent. Then, and this holds true if the base is strictly totally disconnected. So, this is another indication that the category of separated parietal maps for such a strictly totally disconnected base behaves well, because yeah, in this case, these things glue even in the V topology. And there's a final theorem for separated etale maps. And then it's actually a bona fide V stack. Oh, sorry, I should include these subscripts here. Sorry. Then, sorry, the formulation could be improved. I just want to say that this guy is a V-stack. Okay.
And also, I think one should have that the category, the etale topos of the perfectoid space is again behaves well. That is, any etale sheaf probably you can descend.
Any etale sheaf you can also descend. Yes. I think this should follow once I talk about etale sheaves and so on. Yes. Okay. Let me defer this discussion to later. Okay. Okay, so you have some pretty nice descent results. you can also prove that if X is an analytic etic space, then the etale side of X agrees with the etale side of the diamond, where maybe I should say what I mean.
The etale side or
topos? Side, even. So this means that if you want to construct some etale maps to some rigid space, say, you can do it by constructing some etale map to a diamond, and constructing an etale map to a diamond is equivalent to doing it V locally. So you can just cover your diamond by some huge, strictly totally disconnected guy, find an etale cover there, and then apply these descent procedures to, in the end, get some nice etale cover or etale map to a usual rigid space. So As an aside, so this gets used to construct local Shimura varieties, which are, well, these are again some gadgets which depend on some data of a reductive group, a sigma conjugacy class, and a co-character, and some level. And then they should have some period map, pi, going to some flag variety, which depends just on g and mu. And this period map should be etale and separated. But I should make a brief comment. What do I mean by this thing here? Because so far I didn't define what an etale map to a diamond is. So I need to define etale maps of diamonds, or more generally of V-sheaves. So x prime to, well, let's say y prime to y. V sheaves is etale if for all perfectoid spaces x. The map to y, the fiber product is representable in etale. And secondly, it's and here the relevant notion is the one quasi-proetale. If again for all x, but now I just ask it for strictly totally disconnected. X is representable. And then in the strictly totally disconnected base case, quasi-proetale and proetale is the same. And then at least if the morphism is in addition separated, then these descent results tell you that you can check these conditions locally.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, then is the morphism from x to this quotient by the equivalence relation that it has?
I mean, if you have a diamond, you mean? I will answer this in 1 second. So if F is separated, these conditions can be checked V locally by the descent results. So there was a question whether if y is a diamond, and you write y as a quotient of a perfectoid space by a proetale equivalence relation, whether the map from x to y is quasi-proetale, I guess. And this is true. Yeah? It's not representable. It's not true, or I'm not sure I have an example in mind, but I don't know, certainly I don't know how to prove that after a pullback to any x prime mapping to y, the fiber product will be representable. Because I don't have these strong descent results, except if the base is strictly totally disconnected. So what can be proved is if you have a strictly totally disconnected x prime mapping to y, then the fiber product is representable. Sorry, and I should have assumed that X is separated, maybe, to make this statement. I mean, you can always do this by just... you can always replace X by disjoint union of phenoids or something like this.
And what's the etale side of the diamond?
I hoped I could come to this today, but I'm afraid I'm not. Well, because of some issues with separatedness, I don't actually allow all etale morphisms in this end. Let me defer the discussion of the etale side of a diamond actually to a little bit later. Okay. I mean, but covers are just given by families of maps which are jointly surjective as maps of sheaves, which gives you the correct notion of covering, if that is part of the question. And so maybe another remark in the spirit. If Y is a diamond, and Y to Y prime is surjective and quasi-proetal, and now I'm confused whether I need a small separator in this condition, so let me check in the manuscript. I can find it. No, without any. Then Y prime is also a diamond.
Y prime is what?
Is it any other Poincare sheaf? You know, it's enough to assume it's a Poincare sheaf. Okay. Well, if you want, let's see what's a V-sheaf already. But so there's a way to set up definitions and statements in such a way that I could make this for a Poincare sheaf. All right, where am I going, actually? So, so what are we doing? So, so we have this category of diamonds, and we can define some good notions of etale morphisms and quasi-proetale morphisms of diamonds because we have good descent properties, like here. And these are actually V-descent properties. And so this means, this plus some other properties mean that actually a few of the basic things don't just work for diamonds, they work for something much more general, namely any V-sheaf. So there's the following. There's a following funny theorem. that, let's say, Y is any V-sheaf subject to minor set theoretic assumption, so such that there exists this surjective map. Surjective meaning surjective as a map of V-sheaves. from a perfectoid space X. Well, then you can recover Y as a quotient of X by R as V sheaves, where what is the equivalence relation? X times YX. So I should say that I refer to this condition by saying that Y is small. Where the equivalence relation inside of X times X, it's a sub-V-sheaf, it's always a diamond. So any small V-sheaf can be written as a quotient of a perfectoid space by a diamond. Diamonds, in turn, can be written as a quotient of a perfectoid space by a perfectoid space. And so in this kind of two-step procedure, you can reduce many statements for general V-sheaves to this case of perfectoid spaces, which is quite useful sometimes. Yeah?
So, yeah. So the word surjective, so here it was for epimorphism of sheaves, I suppose?
Yes.
And in the original definition, you spoke of surjective maps of affinities. It was on the level of topological spaces, or?
That's on the level of topological spaces, yes. So this uses the following proposition, that if Y is a diamond, Y prime and Y is any sub V sheaf, then Y prime is again a diamond. Which in turn one reduces to the following assertion. That if X is a strictly totally disconnected space, and X prime and X is a sub V-sheaf, and the quasi-compact, I should say. So there is some subtlety. Quasi-complexity that you have to take care of in the reduction, then X prime is actually automatically a strictly totally disconnected space. That's the consequence. I mean, I think what's happening here is that because being a V-sheaf is so strong, it means that you automatically have some kind of geometric structure if you satisfy this V-descent. In particular, what's happening in the proof of this proposition is that if somewhere you have any map from a finite perfectoid space into X that lies in the sub-sheaf, then the map of perfectoid spaces has some image. And the image, by some general nonsense about the topology of spectral spaces, will actually be represented by a strictly totally disconnected space. So there will be a strictly totally disconnected space over which this factors. But then this map must be a V-cover to the subspace because it's surjective on topological spaces. And then the V-sheaf property tells you that actually the subspace lies in the V-sheaf itself. And then you get this.
So it is a subspace closed under generalization?
Yes, all maps are generalizing anyway. So yes, it must be closed under generalization. Well, this means that
about general sheaves can be reduced. First to diamonds and then to perfectoid spaces. So for example, and that's the following lemma, that if f from y prime to y is a quasi-compact and quasi-separated map of V-sheaves. So in any topos, there's a notion of quasi-compact and quasi-separated maps, and I just use this in the case of the topos of V-sheaves. Then it's easy to check whether it's an isomorphism. So then if f is an isomorphism, if and only if, for all algebraically closed non-Archimedean C, field C, with an open and bounded valuation ring, subring, C plus and C, it's bijection on points. Okay, there's some kind of very general statement that there is no non-reduced structure of any kind anywhere here. It's all determined by points. Right, time is coming. Oops. Okay, so let me try to finish this lecture by giving a criterion for a V-sheaf to be a diamond. It's some kind of analog of Artin theorem, giving criteria for algebraic spaces. That's enough to find a smooth cover or something like this. And this is actually used to prove that many of the examples that you care about, or at least in the original argument, this was used to prove that many of the examples you care about are diamonds, like the afferent Grassmannian in this Banji setting and so on. Okay. So this uses a condition on the topological space. Which, by the way, is a condition that will also be important for ruling out the compact Hausdorff spaces. So, let me first define the underlying topological space. Let's say you have a diamond, then you define the underlying topological space to be the quotient, like so. And you check that it is independent of the choice. And also, by making this use of the theorem about small V-sheaves, it also extends to small V-sheaves. Okay. And for perfectoid spaces, it just agrees with the usual underlying topological space. For example, if T is compact Hausdorff, the underlying topological space of this funny sheaf is T. So, for usual perfectoid spaces, you get some locally spectral spaces. Here, you get some compact Hausdorff spaces. And these are some kind of two extremes in the world of topological spaces. And what the condition you're asking is that you are on the spectral side of things. So, small V-sheaf Y is spatial. If essentially, you would like to say that the underlying topological space is quasi-compact and quasi-spectral. But you actually need to say a little bit more. Namely, you need to say that the way the space is spectral is somehow related to some properties of the sheaf. And so the correct way to say this is that it has a basis given by the topological spaces of V for V a quasi-compact open subfunctors. Open sub V sheaves of Y.
What direction is not clear? That those are
These give you quasi-compact open subsets, but not if you would just have a quasi-compact open subspace of the spaces, would not be clear that the associated. Ah, maybe actually. Sorry, I should have said that Y is QCQS and topological space. So it's not clear that if the underlying topological space is quasi-compact, then the sheaf is quasi-compact. The sheaf is quasi-compact if it can be covered by, well, if any cover is a finite subcover. So it's equivalent to asking that it's covered by finitely many affinoid perfectoids.
So then is each of these topological spaces underlying V open and closed
in? It's quasi-compact open in. So if you have a quasi-compact open subsheaf, it will automatically give rise to a quasi-compact open subspace of the topological space. So in general, open subsheaves correspond bijectively to open subspaces of the topological space. But for quasi-compacity, there's only an implication.
So it is not clear that every open subsheaf is a union of partly compact?
It's not clear that any. No, like, I mean, you might have the underlying topological space might a priori be a compact Hausdorff space, so then you don't have any quasi-compact open subspaces. Sorry.
So I don't understand. In the definition, do you require that the V absolute value is what? Is
well, automatically, if V is a quasi-compact open subsheaf of Y, then the V absolute value is a quasi-compact open subspace of absolute value Y.
You mean just the base on the topological space of Y comes from
yes.
open subthing of the final object of Y itself.
Right, but quasi-compact. Okay. And so then there is a proposition that if Y is spatial, then the underlying topological space is spectral. And maybe an important example is that if X is a QCQS analytic etic space, then the associated diamond is spatial. So the ones that come from usual things, they are spatial. And right, and the underlying topological space of X diamond is the underlying topological space of X. Okay, so I'm already over time, so let me just end by stating the theorem. So if Y is a spatial V-sheaf, so you verify this topological condition, and then you just verify a very minor statement about points, such that for all Y in the underlying topological space of Y, there exists a quasi-Kroytal map from some perfectoid space, which you can assume to be some sparse CC plus to Y, with Y in the image. On topological spaces. Then Y is actually a spatial diamond. So you just need to check that the points of the space are not too bad. But for example, if you are in the situation of the FN-Grassmannian, where you apply this, for example, there is already a stratification of the space for which you know that the strata are diamonds. And so any one of those points will lie in one of those strata, and then you just, because it's a diamond there, you know this condition. And so this means that you only have to verify the spatiality condition here. And, well, that's some points of topology, which is fun or not, but anyway. Let me stop here.
Any questions?
What is the Artin's theorem of which it's another?
Well, I mean, it's roughly an analog of the theorem that if you want to prove that something is an algebraic space, you don't actually have to find an etale atlas up, but it's enough to find some smooth atlas or maybe flat atlas or something like that.
Ah, a smooth atlas with no. Okay.
Yeah. And so here again, well, for a small V-sheaf, you automatically have some V-atlas. So the vague analogy is somehow that I consider the quasi-Kroytal side as being vaguely analogous to etale things in the scheme case, and then any V-maps is being vaguely analogous to all flat maps in the scheme case.
But you thought there are no fineness conditions, and in Artin it's probably just FPPF.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So, no other questions. Let's thank the speaker again.